The first reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 5. There's a little bit of background. This takes place after the disciples have received the Holy Spirit. They're in the temple preaching. They've been preaching so enthusiastically that the Sanhedrin and the Sadducees in the Sanhedrin have gotten kind of put out with them. So they threw them in jail. And they spent the night in jail, but during the night, an angel of the Lord came and let them go. So they got out the next morning, and of course, what did they do? First thing, they ran away. No, they did not run away. They started preaching again. So this time, they clamped them in irons and took them before the Sanhedrin. And this is where the story begins. They asked them what they were doing, and Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." When they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed the Sanhedrin. "Men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Thaddeus appeared, claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him. He was killed. All his followers were dispersed, and it came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too was killed, and all his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go, for if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God." His speech persuaded them. They called the apostles in and had them flogged. Then they ordered them to not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. This gospel reading is from the book of John, chapter 20. As a little background, this is Easter evening. In the morning, the women have been to the tomb, have come back, and told the amazing story that Jesus is alive. I don't know if they can believe it or not. I don't know if I could believe it. Seeing is believing. But here they are. They're all together. They've had this fantastic story that Jesus is alive. And this is how the story goes. John 20. In the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hands into his side, I will not believe." A week after his disciples were in the house again, a week later, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. The prodigal is welcomed home, the sinner now a saint. For the God who died came back to life, and everything has changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? The mighty King of Kings has disarmed you. Delivered and redeemed, each hurdle life is out. Oh, praise his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. And all throughout eternity, our song will be the same. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Sweet embrace, I see your scars, your open arms, and the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah! Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting?
So what do you think the next life will be like? It seems like in America, everybody has an idea of the next life, whatever that would be. You know, the typical thing people say, well, you know, I feel grandma's looking down on me and I feel like she's with me. And that's an idea, I guess, of the afterlife. Here we are at the Lincoln Memorial here in Redlands. Some people think that, like Lincoln, you should leave a legacy behind you. And then if people remember you and remember your legacy, well, that's how you live on. That's your form of the afterlife. Some people think there's ancestor worship that way. And if you don't remember your ancestor, then it's like they're lost in a fog because they're not being remembered. And not being remembered is like having no life or an empty life. Evolutionists, of course, think that there's no life to follow at all. You just die. You weren't the fittest, and so you died, and that's the end of things. There's the idea of reincarnation, that your body gets kind of recycled like an aluminum can, but you come out as a different person with a different life and a different body. There's the idea in Catholicism of purgatory, you know? Well, then you're just looking forward to thousands of years of suffering. There's the Mormon idea that if you're a really good Mormon, you become a god if you're a man, or you become a wife of a god if you're a woman. But if you're not a very good Mormon, you just serve a god and you aren't married at all. So there's lots of ideas about the afterlife and what that would be. But does it matter what belief in the afterlife you have? Well, yeah, it does, because really all of the beliefs or values that we hold do affect our lives in some way. It might affect it in a small way or a large way. A strong belief may affect our lives more than a weak belief. But yes, the beliefs we have affect what we do and how we live. For instance, if you believe you're able to get away with stuff because you're smarter than everyone, well then, yeah, you're the CEO that will pilfer its company. If you believe, for instance, eat and drink for tomorrow you die, well then, probably your life will include eating, drinking, and partying and go no farther than that. If you think that life will never get better, it'll only get worse, well, then that leads to hopelessness, a lack of ambition, maybe giving up. Now, here we are at the Lincoln Memorial, and he had some strong beliefs. He did believe in the Bible and the resurrection and lived according to Christian principles. He also believed in saving the Union. And so he had courage to follow through on those strong beliefs of his. So what we believe about the next life does affect how we live now as well as how we live in the future. Of course, Jesus Christ did believe in the next life. He prophesied that he himself would be arrested by the Jews, condemned by the Gentiles, that he would be killed, tortured on the cross, die, and yet come back to life again. He had that strong belief or teaching in what we call the afterlife or the resurrection. That belief carried him through the suffering of the cross because it was suffering for him, as you can see, sweating drops of blood at Gethsemane. Hebrews says, for the joy set before him, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame, and sat down at the throne of God. That joy was what he pictured in the resurrection life and took him through that suffering, gave him present strength, gave him present courage and faith. And in the same way that can be for us, if we hold belief in the resurrection as Christ teaches and did. Okay, so what does Christ's resurrection show us about the many beliefs that people have about the resurrection or about the next life? What do Jesus' teachings tell us about that? Does he teach reincarnation? Well, no, not at all. Reincarnation is almost the opposite of resurrection. In reincarnation, you come back as another body, another mind, but you come back to suffer. And Hindus, Buddhists who hold to the reincarnation don't really want to reincarnate because to them you have to come back and suffer again in another life. It holds no hope at all for those who really believe in reincarnation. That's not what Jesus taught. The resurrection certainly is different than evolution. The best evolution can do is to say that somehow your genes, your DNA, lives on to some degree in your descendants, if you have any. But there's no personal hope in that. You're still dead. You still have no existence. What about the idea of a grandma looking down on you? Well, that's a temporary, really an emotional way to deal with grief. It really, for most people, isn't really a held belief. it's like having emotion without any fact behind it, and so it has some emptiness there. It doesn't go past or any further than the feeling does. The feeling of purgatory, well, there's no grace in that. It's just more suffering, worse suffering than what you have here. So all these kind of false teachings about the afterlife send you into sort of a slow motion disappointment without any real purpose or goal in life, a feeble effort to do good. Has little hope for the future and really no joy in the future. And remember what that verse says, for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. For the joy set before him. How can we look forward to and hold on to joy as we look forward to the next life? So what is death and the resurrection like? Well, I'm sitting here in a bus stop in Redlands. Now, no one wants to be in a bus stop. I mean, it's uncomfortable. There's noise of cars going by. You're out in the elements. You know, it's only, we only go in a bus stop because it's a transition to a destination someplace better. It's the destination that we're looking for when we're in a bus stop. Well, this is what death is like for a Christian. It's just a transition looking towards a destination. And the destination we look for, is a new heavens and a new earth and a renewed body in which we can see Christ Jesus face to face. Now, what was the resurrection of Jesus like? What was he like when he resurrected? Seeing what he was like gives you an idea what our resurrection will be like. Now, if you had a camera like this one in the first century, if you could have taken a picture of Jesus with your camera, would he have appeared on the picture? Do you think that he would have appeared on the picture? Would you be able to see his or hear his voice? Would he just be like a ghost? Would he be like a vision, imagination of the disciples? What would it be? Well, what we see from the Gospels, and today's Gospel is John 20, is that Jesus appeared not just in someone's vision or imagination or as a ghost, but in a real resurrected body. This is the account from John. The doors were locked when the disciples were there for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." He showed them his hands and his side, and they were glad when they saw the Lord. And then they touched him, and they really realized he was not a ghost. Now, before this, that's the best they could imagine, is that he would be a ghost. You remember when they were out in a storm at night on the Sea of Galilee. They were there on Galilee, and Jesus came to them on the water, and they thought he was a ghost, because that's all they could imagine. Well, our visions of eternal life really are limited in the same way. Jesus shows us a resurrection that goes beyond just a ghost or an imagination. It goes to the real physical resurrection of Jesus. He wasn't just remembered. He was restored in a new body and a new life. And that's why they were glad when they saw the Lord, because they knew him once again in much the same way they'd known him before, but resurrected in glory. The other thing you notice about the resurrection is that they recognize Jesus immediately. There's no question about who this is. They see Jesus, in a sense, as they've seen him before, with that same face and same body. It's a renewed body, of course, and because they recognize Jesus, they're glad. And certainly, before this time, they were glad every time they saw Jesus. But after the terror of the crucifixion, so much the more. And seeing him in a resurrected body brought them all the much more joy. Okay, but they recognize him, and this is important because it shows that the relationship that they began with him continued then after the resurrection. They knew him, and he knew them, and the relationship that they began actually increased and enhanced because the things of sin that had kept them apart joined them together once in a way. So what this shows us is, in the resurrection, we will recognize Christ Jesus and our loved ones and continue a relationship we had with them before. You notice Jesus says to them, "Peace be with you." It shows that in the resurrection, in that next life, is peace with God. And this is important, because very often what people picture as what comes after this life isn't one of peace. It's just the opposite instead. But in the resurrection of Jesus, there is peace and there is joy. And it shows that he has a real body. His body is completely healed instantaneously. The wounds, the torture of the crucifixion are gone, and he has a full, vital, healed body and comes to them with that. They can touch him as they do periodically thereafter. Now, there are still the nail marks in the hands and in the side, but they aren't open wounds. In fact, they're wounds of honor, because they show that the crucifixion, the redemption, was complete, and it freed us from sin. And so those marks are marks of honor. And the Bible doesn't say this, but I kind of personally think that the martyrs that give their lives because of the Lord will also have marks of honor because of the commitment that showed. He eats with them. You see, this shows us that they didn't just remember Christ Jesus, but that his body was restored in the resurrection. It's a wonderful thought. He has superpowers. He can suddenly appear and suddenly disappear. And immortal, never sick again and never to die again. He's now exalted, Acts says, and Lord of heaven and earth. No longer hidden by this human body that keeps us from understanding and knowing him. But they recognize he's the resurrected and exalted Lord. I know that my Redeemer lives, such comfort this sweet sentence gives. He lives who once was dead. He lives my ever-living head. Okay, now why is this in the gospel? Now, many of the events that are in the gospels are ones that the apostles experience, and we just read about. We don't experience those. They experienced the healings, for instance, of Lazarus. We just read about them. But this is a unique thing. In the resurrection of the Lord, it's something we will experience, not just read about someone else experiencing. This is a striking thing. We will experience the risen Lord in the future, and we will experience what it's like to be resurrected from the dead. The Creed says this: I believe the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of the God, the Father Almighty. I believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Okay, so what this means for us is that we don't just remember the Lord Jesus, but rather his body was restored, resurrected, and our bodies will be restored or resurrected as well. Okay, what does this mean? First of all, it means we should invest in the lives we have now. Jesus says, love God with your whole heart and soul and mind and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This is how we should invest our lives, not waiting for the next life to somehow do better, but rather use this life that he gives us to serve him. Resurrection isn't a second chance at life. It's the culmination of this life, an exciting thing. It also gives us hope. Now, we're afraid of the virus right now, okay, but the fact is, sooner or later, we will contract a disease of some kind and we will die. And so this is no different, in a sense, in this time of the virus, because we still need to approach life with hope, expecting that God will reverse the diseases and death of this life and give us new life instead. We have delight in the new body Christ Jesus has and the new bodies we will have. And more than that, we can take delight in the new minds we will have as well, with no more regrets, no more guilt, no more sadness. And our entirely emotional life will be restored, just as great as our physical life is restored. And this is where the joy comes from. It said, for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. And likewise, for the joy set before us, we can endure whatever comes to us and serve Christ Jesus with a full heart and come to that with thanksgiving and gratefulness, because it's his redemption that wins this eternal life for us. For whoever believes in him will receive eternal life, as he's promised. Christ lives and grants me daily breath. He lives and I shall conquer death. He lives my mansion to prepare. He brings to bring me safely there. You can join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.